And what can lead our great optimism, economic growth for the future? So we will look for the new futures with our families, Huang Fu, Vice President JAC International China, Farah London, Founder Back to Business International United Kingdom, David Tan, Executive Dean, Shang College, Shenzhou University, China, Sha Tang, President Brazil, China Chamber of Commerce, Brazil, Zhang Hotao, President Xinhua Group, China. And the session will be moderated by J.T. Lee, Professor from Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, Hong Kong, China. So the stage is yours.
Okay, so it's a wonderful. Good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to the closing plenary for our 2024 Horizons China meeting, where we have examined the vast opportunities for cooperation and development between China and Vietnam. I'm J.T. Lee, a professor at Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. During the opening ceremony this morning, His Excellency, the Deputy Prime Minister, described the relationship between China and Vietnam as mountains and rivers with a long and rich history. China stands as Vietnam's the largest trading partner, and Vietnam is also China's largest partner among ASEAN countries. With the United GDP growing at 5.1% just last year and projected to grow even further, it emerges as a robust growth environment and resources in Asia. The state visit by Chinese President Xi Jinping to Vietnam last December saw the signing of over 30 cooperation agreements covering various aspects like Belt and Road Initiative, development of cooperation, digital economy, and green development. These agreements signify a deepening of China-Vietnam relations, expanding the scope for cooperation. Reflecting the insights from 2024 Horizons China meeting, it's clear there are both exciting opportunities and the challenges facing China, facing Chinese and Vietnamese business and entrepreneurs and their international partners. So with us today, we are very excited to share five very distinguished speakers to discuss these opportunities and the challenges for economic growth and development, reflecting on races as the global business community that is so ably led by Frank, right? So first I will briefly introduce each of our five distinguished speakers in alphabetical order. To my immediate right, is Mr. Huang Fu, also called Huang. Mr. Huang is the Vice President for Anhui Jianghui Auto Group, JAC. He's one of the leading auto companies in China. With a wealth of experience in the auto industry, Mr. Huang has been instrumental in driving innovation and fostering strategic partnership to promote sustainable development within the auto sector. To my immediate left is Ms. Farah Linden. Ms. Linden is the founder of the Back to Business International, a permanent organization dedicated to facilitating international business and collaborations. With her very impressive and extensive background in business development, entrepreneurship, and civic leadership, Ms. Linden brings a unique perspective on global business trends and opportunities for collaboration. Also to my further left is Dr. David Pan. Dr. Pan served as Executive Dean of Schwarzman College at Tsinghua University in China one of China's premier academic institutions. As a respected academic leader, Dr. Pan is renowned for his expertise in education innovation and also internet collaboration. So with a focus on driving economic growth, talent development, and research excellence. To my further right is Mr. Pan. Ms. Pan is the president of Brazil, China Chamber of Commerce, a key organization facilitating trade and investment between Brazil and China. With his international experience in international business and diplomacy, Ms. Pan has been instrumental in promoting economic collaboration and fostering mutual understanding between the two countries. To my further left is Mr. Zhang Huaikao. Mr. Zhang is president of Xinhua Group, a modern enterprise group with a diverse interest, including power generation, aluminum production, and green building materials, with a strong commitment to sustainability and innovation. Mr. Zhang has played an important role in driving the group's growth and contributing to the sustainable development, both domestically and internationally. Okay, with that as a brief introduction to my very distinguished panelists, I will now open the panel with one opening question, right? So my first question is this, right? With what role can international cooperation and partnership play in enhancing the economic prospects of China and Vietnam, particularly in sectors such as trade, investment, technology transfer, and education? We can start with Lady first, right? Farah, you are passionate about education, entrepreneurship, and civic leadership. And you bring a global perspective, right, from United Kingdom and beyond. What's your thoughts on this first opening question?
Thank you so much, JT. I get really excited when we start talking about China and international business, because China is a dominating factor. Now, when I hear nations challenge and say China's a competitor, I have to challenge that narrative, because China isn't a competitor, they are a market leader. Let's be honest. They dominate most of the industry sectors globally. Now, China has thousands of years of trade experience. They have been trading for thousands of years. And it's this knowledge that actually has put China where it is now. They understand the importance of international business and working with partners. For example, you were talking about the Belt and Road Initiative. If we look at the China-Europe trade, it leaves from China and goes all the way through to Europe and ends in Hamburg, taking Chinese goods and produce. And then it returns, taking European goods back to China. Now, just in 2021, they had $6 billion worth of trade, east and west. And that shows you how China really understands trade and investment. Just from Germany, for example, a month they take 20 container loads of German beer back to China. And that really emphasizes my point then. Now, what I love about China is its willingness to exchange R&D. They do a lot of exchange internationally, and I've been proud to actually be part of facilitating that. And that's why Vietnam is actually in a great position to work with China, because China will really bring its expertise, its experience to Vietnam. And I really see the two nations working collaboratively together.
Thank you so much for the insights. Especially, of course, in terms of the collaborations in technology between China and Vietnam, because there's a potential there. I will now turn to Dr. David Pan, right? Dr. Pan, educator with Sportsman College. The program's objective is to bring future global leaders to Tsinghua as we to enhance the understanding between China, the United States, and the rest of the world. So you can bring a unique perspective to this international collaboration now between China and the United. What's your perspective?
Thank you, Professor Li, and also thank you, Dr. Frank, and organize this today's great event. And so our topic is looking to the future. What's the future? Future is the young generation. And for the young generation, you know, I arrived yesterday, and today I met a lot of college students and volunteers, and they are full of energy from the mainland, and they are so professional. And that is the future. And so that's how can make a future better. So that is education. So my college is funded 11 years ago, and 80% is international students. And Dr. Frank and give the lecture to our future leaders, our mission. And every year, Tsinghua has Vietnam students and cover all over the world. So far, we have 96 countries, students come to Tsinghua to study. That study, you understand each other, learn each other, and make future our topic, future is better. So that's cooperation based on the education. So that is very important. Here, I invite all of the professionals that everyone sitting here come to Tsinghua, come to our college to teach our scholars to make our future better. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pan. Right, indeed, the Sportsman Model, right, fostering the understanding between China and the US and the rest of the world is a form of future global leaders, right? Those are actually the examples that can also be for forcing the leaders from Vietnam and China, right? To understand.
Absolutely.
So thank you. Now I will turn to Mr. Charles. Right? So Charles, you are a leader who made a tremendous contribution for the understanding collaboration between China and Brazil. Right? So I know you bring a unique perspective. In fact, probably hold the record for the number of hours you fly, right, from Brazil to this meeting, right? I know it's a long hours, so I want to thank you so much for your dedication to the Horizons Global community, right? And so what's your perspective? Looking at from your experiences in Brazil and your work on collaboration in China.
I'm very glad to be here. I first joined the Horizons in 15 years ago when it was the Europe-China business meeting in Frankfurt. So I'm an old friend of Frank, and of course, because of his meetings are so grand that I have been joining his meeting for 15 years. But anyhow, China is grew 5.2% last year. Although the Western media is very gleefully saying that China economy is in big trouble, what is normal is that most countries have ups and downs. The economy of every country in the world has ups and downs. What is not normal is that China only had ups. China never had downs. Now it's slowing a little bit. 5.2% growth is very, very reasonable, especially the post-pandemic era. The Western media say that China has a big growth, economic growth. I believe that China will continue to grow. I believe that China has the resources to continue to grow. And that Vietnam, in collaboration with China, will continue to grow as well. And Vietnam is in a very good position because it does business with the West and it does business with China. It's not involved in the, let's say, trade cold war between the West and China. But I think that the collaboration between both countries will continue to grow. And in fact, many of the Chinese companies are investing in Vietnam because of the cost difference of trust between China and Vietnam, and also because of the fact that Vietnam is trading without any problems with the whole world, the West and the East. And I'm very happy to find my friend from Jack Bolton's, Jiang Wai, automobile company, because many years ago, I was the one who took the first Chinese automobile company to Brazil, and it's doing very well in Brazil. Jiang Wai is doing very well in Brazil, and I was the one who brought the Brazilian dealer to become the representative of Jack in Brazil. So I think that the same thing now, of course, Jack is in Vietnam. He can tell you about the success story of Jack in Vietnam. But I think that the business collaboration between China and Vietnam will continue to grow and continue to prosper as both economies will continue to grow. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chen, for sharing your insights. You stress, for example, UNAP, this tremendous opportunity for the restructuring of the global value chain, right? Where we see lot investment from China, right? They are moving their operations here. And one example actually is the gentleman sitting on my right. So it's truly a globalizing world, but it's also a very small world. Right? This is the time, you know, some years ago you helped with JHC, expanding to Brazil, right? And today we are sitting in Brazil, and we are talking about opportunity right in Vietnam. It's a good dream. Globalized world was a very small. So today we are also very, you know, very fortunate to have two business leaders from China sitting here on the panel. Right. So let me first turn to my right, Mr. Ford, right? Very perfect. Mr. Ford of JAG, right? Mr. Ford, your company has established an operation right here since 2010. In fact, talking to you, you have been visiting Vietnam for over 100 times, right? Hopefully, it's not all for business. Hopefully, you have time to look at the cities as well, right? So, what's your perspective on the opportunities and the challenges for collaboration between China and Vietnam, right? And also, if I may, I can speak a little bit in Chinese to expand it a little bit. So, we have been changing the trading team,
谢谢李教授。 中国是世界上第二大贸易经济体，中国始终秉承着对外开放的这样一个原则。中国的“一带一路”的倡议，在推进这个“一带一路”的这些倡议的10年之际，中国已经和全球的150个国家。 30个世界组织里面，合作达成了230份这样的一个国际合作这样的文件，为共建国的整个一个贸易的发展，邻近货物的 P 平均增长量8%，特别也认为全球经济的推动和整个一个亚洲经济的推动做出了巨大的贡献。那么越南是我们的东盟的新型经济体，从1986年越南的革新开放以来啊，越南政府已经落实了市场经济改革，吸引外资，对外开放，经济已经取得了令人瞩目的成绩，平均的整个 GDP 每年都达到6%，位居高的 GDP 的国家行列。刚才李教授问到了我们张系阶层，那我想简单的介绍一下我们的张系阶层。张系集团的全称是安徽江淮劳动贸易委 Company Limited， 实际上它是一家生产商用车、乘用车、新能源汽车、智能网联汽车于一体的综合性的汽车集团，它也是我们中国企业走出去的重要的一员。随着我们对外的国际开拓的不断的拓展，我们的产品已经覆盖了全球130个国家和地区，而且随着我们的国际市场的不断的发展和壮大，我们已经在全球19个国家建立了海外的开拓点。我们已经从单一的贸易型向属地化生产进行转移。那我们在2010年，我们在越南的平阳省顺化市，我们建立了第一家我们的海外的开拓点，一直运营将近14年的时间。我们在这个十几年之间呢，我们也遇到了一些困难。一开始的经营利益也不是特别的理想。那么，在平阳省政府和顺化市的相关部门的领导的大力的支持和帮助下，我们的合资企业取得了快速的发展。那么经济效益目前已经取得了良好的市场。那么作为汽车行业的从业人员，我想对中越的汽车经济的展望，我想提3点看法。那么第一个方面应该是持续要坚持合作共赢、共担责任，以共赢凝聚共识，在全球国际化的大的背景下，那我们中越的汽车行业我们必须共担责任。那么这个主要是不限于我们技术方面的合作、市场的规范，还有我们标准的建立。我们通过共赢的模式，我们双方必须建立互信、互利、互惠的合作关系。那么第二个方面，我们还要共赢挑战，还要以包容和务实的态度深化合作。在全球经济的不确定性和行业内的竞争压力的加大，那我想我们的中越的这个企业必须共同面对这样的挑战。同时我们还要以包容的心态，要理解双方存在的差异，还要以合作实际行动来扩展我们技术。我们具有本着这个务实的合作的态度，我们双方的这个情感才能共同的扩展。那么第三个方面，像我们是共赢机遇、共享发展，以中国创新经济为中越的经济带动动力， 这话是怎么说呢？说中国经济的规模增长了，我们不能简单的理解为它的数量上太过的理解我们在中国在汽车行业的整个一个创造力在不断的提升。那我想我们的工业经济必须抓住这一轮的创新的机会，我们通过我们自己本身的创新，我们中越的经济是以绿色转型和我们智能转型来带动区域经济的高质量发展，让我们的中越经济啊会开辟新的天地和新的篇章。谢谢。
啊，十分感谢啊，黄总啊 ，Thank you very much, Mr. Huang. So I especially like the the several points insights you have. For example, you talk about win-win collaborations, right? Win-win collaborations. You talk about a trust. You talk about a mutual understanding of differences, right? These are of course are very important. Now, last but not least. Let me turn to Mr. Zhang, Mr. Zhang, your group has been a leader in promoting renewable energy and carbon reduction. And can you share your insights about the opportunities for collaboration, especially in sustainable development area between China and Vietnam? If I may, maybe I can also speak a little bit in Chinese, right?就是建议于税法集团在各个行业从中丰富的经验，以应对税法集团在跨境合作与创新这一块怎样可以有哪些措施推动本地区的可持续性发展。谢谢，谢谢张总。
我是来自信发集团的张海涛。那么中国的电解铝工业有色工业，那么现在已经占到了世界的一半了。那么越南现在的铝产业还有很大的提升。那么这次来呢，越南的经济人口发展很快，那必然也需要大量的铝制品。那么信发集团呢，现在下游的企业现在也在出口越南的铝矿材质，目前也在越南进行建厂投资。那么铝工业的发展势必带来能源、原料以及电力正常高速的发展，但是铝是耗电的。那么越南有没有准备接纳铝工业升级？怎样抉择？那以及对资源的开发、高效利用和绿色能源的这种矛盾怎样选择？那么这一个是一个问题。那么至少现在越南有2万亩生产，那么现在来讲越南的铝还在大量的进口，在资源的开发和利用，那么和二氧化碳的排放的考虑，那么如果这个决策正确，那么会对越南的经济就会有很强有力的发展。但是世界需要什么？那么越南的现在的经济发展，如果我们大家对于越南的了解，人口状况、经济发展的状况，那么这里呢，铝的进口是非常多的，但是企业发展竞争力，那对于无论是企业、地域还是国家，它是有选择性的，强者恒强。那也很欣喜地看到越南的发展势头蓬勃，经济增速很高，社会稳定。这次论坛呢，也见证了越南的发展环境，
但是工业没有国界，企业没有国界，企业是推动世界经济的发展。哪个地区国家的经济发展快，那么哪个国家的富强，人民就安居乐业。那么工业生产在适合的地方发展，还有世界很多国家的资源条件非常好，但是政策、基础建设、人力、交通还存在着不足。那么我认为这不是问题。企业能看到优势，会规避这些缺点或者说不足。那么这些地方它本身就有资源，那么怎样结合绿色的发展？那么集团呢现在在是循环经济，在我们电力里发电、氧化的碳素化工建材的，那么在国内呢也在布局绿色的。那么越南呢现在铝的需求非常大，那么这个问题呢我认为应该会很好的解决，都面临着发展和绿色能源的问题。这个呢我认为在越南是有条件来发展的有色工业这一块，前景非常好。
谢谢张总啊 ，Thank you, Mr. Zhang, for sharing your insights. Especially about the sustainable development, green energy, green development. So I want to thank all the speakers for sharing your insights. Right, in looking at the future for growth and development in each region, right? One important aspect, right, the attracting investment is really about what we call soft.The soft part, the cultural heritage, right? The supporting policies and institutions, right? The development of human capital, right? And education, and entrepreneurship, and leadership. Ms. Lindsay, so maybe we can start with you. Will you please share your insights, right, about these issues?
Absolutely. Looking to the future, I think.Nations are understanding now we need to have open borders. And something China has done fairly recently is most European countries can now travel to China visa-free. Now this is going to obviously drive the tourism to China, but also it's going to drive business tourism, which is a very important key factor. And through this drive of business tourism coming into China,What I can really see happening between China and Vietnam is a lot of opportunities for private-public partnerships. And I feel that the private sector can really drive the business opportunity in JV partnerships between China and Vietnam. And it is the private sector that will spearhead that. And China and Vietnam have a great cultural identity. They have many similarities.And they can use that as a key factor to do business exchange together. Because with a strong cultural identity and soft power, it enables two nations to grow together. And as we heard from the Deputy Prime Minister earlier this morning, Vietnam is open for business and they want to engage with China. And I think it's fantastic that they open doors because China will bring a wealth of knowledge, expertise, also much needed labor as well, and train people in Vietnam. You talked about entrepreneurship. We need to ensure the younger generation you were discussing, they are the future. So we need to make sure that both China and Vietnam are pushing entrepreneurship.To the younger generation, helping startups thrive. Because that is the future. The younger generation, we need to empower them. And that will be through education. Education is the key factor, the key element that will push this forward. And I would love to see reform in education. I'd love to see more innovative education in the curriculum. We're trying to obviously do that in the UK as well. But I think one problem that we have in the UK, and probably actually globally, is we're not teaching in schools or colleges how to do business, how to set up business, how to open a business, money management. And these are key skills, life skills, that students should be learning and need to learn.
Thank you, Maya. I know you're passionate about education, right? Of course, Yuna is open for business, right? One important you mentioned about, of course, you know, the people changes on the economy, right? So we have tourism, we have the private sectors, private investors, companies come to visit, right? And engaging businesses, they are entrepreneurship, right? Okay, so now let's turn to data plan, right? Dr. Pan, you are, of course, in the area of leadership education, right? Especially, you know, Schwarzman College is a one-child in the United States and China, right? So I wonder what insight you can provide to us about the, you know, collaboration between China and China in this sense.
Professor Li, and I fully agree with Howard just mentioned, you know, there's, you know, China has a reform and openness for 45 years. And the experience, that's what the experience we learn. And the number one, I think, is attitude. So attitude is, what is attitude? Attitude is to learn from others. We have to learn from others. We have successful stories. We have failure stories. We learn from failure stories and the successful stories. We can learn. So that's the China and Vietnam and learning, right? Learn each other and move mutual benefit together. And answer the professor's question. You know, for in the future, for the soft power is absolutely is education. How to education? What's important in education? A lot of things we need to educate. What's number one? And that is today, you know, the Vietnam is a growing, economically growing. We need a lot of managers. We need a lot of professionals as well as China. Back to 1992, and China started to set up MBA program. Why the MBA program? We need managers to manage growing business. So that entrepreneurs today, we mentioned. So that today, the leadership, entrepreneur, and all the educators put together, what we do that for is for our growth, for our growing. Yesterday, I met a group of students. I asked, what's your major? What's that? The major is a tourist. Why is it tourist? Because a lot of visitors here. So if you went to a group in the city, HIC, you can see a lot of foreigners. They need to get a train and talk to them in English or in anyone and anything for the foreigners. Same as 30 years or 20 years ago in time. So that's the learning job. So number one, it's IDP. Number two, by the focus on which one is more important, entrepreneurship, leadership. And all of this, we need educate. So we need to train our next generation. And the professor said, so Schwarzman College from 2013, that's the purpose, that the mission is cultivate the future leaders, that future leaders and the global vision, China, Vietnam, US, Europe, everyone. And that is the global vision for the next generation. So that's a part of the sophomore. We cannot isolate ourselves. So that's
Thank you very much. David, for sharing your insights. So let's turn to Charles, right? So you are, you know, you have a lot of experiences working in learning in Brazil, right? So over the years you have observed the development of China and the, you know, relationship with Brazil, right? What's your comment on the short term? Right, the development of people, the development of institutions, right, and the development of you know, some culture.
You know, I'm also the chairman of the Brazilian Association of Waste to Energy and Hydrogen. And also, I'm also a board member of the National Confederation of Small Family Agriculture and Entrepreneurs focusing on the Amazon. We have 8 million members, and we are training. We pay the young Indian tribes, members of the tribes, to alert the authorities when there is tree cutting and when there is illegal mining. So we're very focused on ESG. And I think that our Brazil-China relations are very important, that both China and Brazil are very much concerned about clean energy. And in fact, most of the clean energy in Brazil is made from Chinese solar panels and wind machines and so on. So we're going to supply most of the in the Amazon forest, many, many cities, villages use diesel fuel to power their generators. We're going to supply them and the homes with home solar kits. And the small villages with largest solar energy for their hospitals and schools and living conditions. I think there's a close relationship between Brazil and China, also in the clean energy area. And so, CONAFER, which is the Confederation of Small Agricultural Entrepreneurs, we have a university called Universitas in the Amazon, which focuses on the research and study of the Amazon biomass. The world wants to save the Amazon, and we at CONAFER, we have been doing that since 2011. Hopefully we can also have an agreement with Tsinghua University to focus on saving not only the Amazon, but the other rainforests around the world. So for me, I spend my time in doing this out of passion. Although I'm not, I was transferred to Brazil by a Wall Street investment bank, and I do a lot of mergers and acquisitions. But this work I do because of passion, to save the world, to save our planet, and to save our Amazon rainforest.
Thank you so much, Charles, for sharing your experiences, especially on the solar panels, the green technology, green energy, right? So I will turn to Mr. Fong, right? So you are involved in innovation, right? Like the new energy, electricity vehicles, right? And we talk about the soft power in promoting economic development for China. And the Yunnan, the soft power also including the sustainable development, the new the renewable energy, and also of course EV, right? So allow me to see a little bit in Chinese, right? 就是在中文的话里面，就是在将来车在早在2016年已经开始跟未来合作，在生产电动车、新能源汽车，对吧？
那我在想就是说你们在中越国在电动车也经过发展的合作方面的机会和挑战，你们能这方面稍微简单的介绍一下，谢谢。谢谢教授，这个在谈到新能源这边，和大家欣赏。我们中国的话在 2023年 我们整个一个产销的3000万台，我们的这种新能源呢700万台，但是说我们新能源整个一个出进120万， 也就是一个局面。我讲的这个话的意思，我在中国市场经历智能网通过这个大量的实践的也非常厉害。所以越来越对我们的人，我们在一起啊，因为我们中国的这个汽车厂商啊，他很了解智能新能源，很亲近的能源，但是越来越市场，越来越汽车工业的人，他更了解当地性和当地的成本的话，如果我们这两点先结合在一起，共同的合作和研发，是不是当地的这一种，认为在越南是新能源，那是大有可能。我很客观的说，现在的越南的很多的事情，但是这些摩托车的部分，哪怕有十分之一，转化成使用新能源轿车，那是一个非常可观的潜在的。举起来说，刚才讲的关于文采，就是我们的公司为什么在越南的培养上，培养上，越南的人超过1亿了，年轻人员的话，他的平均年龄32岁，那平阳省更多的会是华人，还有英语教育开始，不像在政府还挺。它的产业链基本性，那么人才是我们汽车行业的基本基石。那我们从人才的培养角度，看你看，一个汽车行业现在需要什么样的人才？那么中越汽车行业，我们可以把它做成啊，比如说我们基本的这些人才，需要汽车的产业工人，汽车的维修工。汽车的服装工人，汽车的焊工，在这个上面有这样的很多的来进行培训和培养。那么第二个，对于高端人才的培训，这些高端人才，我想我们中越两国的高校和我们的汽车研发机构要建立这样的互动和联系。这样的互动联系的主要是为了培育高端的管理人才。第二个，高端的设计人才，还有海运物流人才，我觉得这些人才如果全部都到位了，我想对中越的整个一个汽车产业，特别是新能源的这样的一个汽车产业，那是非常到位。那么第三个呢，一个是供应链的整合和优化。供应链的整合，我们中国的这边关于新能源的这边供应链已经非常成熟了。那越南的企业可以嫁接在我们中国的新能源的这个产业的这些基础上，去在越南当地进行本地化生产。这些本地化生产可以把这些部件可以在越南当地，甚至到东盟市场来进行配套使用。这样的话，可以拓展第三方的整个一个配套的资源，也可以装调成新能源汽车。除了覆盖我们越南市场以外，还可以覆盖一些东盟的市场，为适应 RCEP 的整个一个主力化满足力的要求。李教授，我就报告这个。
哦，谢谢黄总啊，说 Thank you, Mr. Huang. So I really share your insight, right? China, Yunnan.Could be leaders in renewable, sustainable energy and also transportation. Mr. Zhang, you are a private owned company in Shandong province, right? And one of the business entities you have is power generation. 就张总刚才讲的，就说你们是在山东的民营企业，其中你们主要的一个业务就是发电产业。就我let me just speak in Chinese, but to ask a question first. 就是我就想问一下，就是特别是你刚才我们讲可再生能源，比如太阳能啊，比如说这个绿色能源，对吧？你们能不能分享一下，在这 renewable energy 可再生能源方面，中国与越南 合作发展前景。So I was just asking, since Mr. Zhang's company is also in the power generation business, so I was asking what's the future of renewable energy, right, for collaboration between China and Vietnam in the future. Thank you.
绿色能源是世界各国的共识。那么我也有幸呢，随着中国代表团参加迪拜COP28的峰会。那么世界各国呢，由于工业发展不同阶段和程度，对于碳排放有不同的认识。那么作为中国方面呢，中国现在在积极的践行36零计划。那么虽然中国的基数比较大，但中国的努力也是世界主流。那么作为新发集团，那么新发集团就是始终坚持以最低的资源和能源消耗为社会创造最大的价值，优化产业结构，加快厂房升级。那么这里面呢，就是关于绿色能源，一定要火电是加强式，那么绿电要大力发展。那整个集团呢，现在大力在投资啊新能源的建设。我们在新疆啊，投资48亿元，建设280兆瓦圆环和主一体化的项目。那么投资94亿元的建设1340兆瓦风电项目。那么要从源头上抢，这个呢，我感觉啊，越南做得非常好。他现在在全力啊，在打造绿色的园区。那这个呢，就是需要能源消耗可以不稳定的企业入驻园区。那么能源消耗大，要求稳定的，这个呢，现在目前世界还做不到绿色能源全部在运行。那么在国外呢，发达的欧洲有一些呢，能做到全面绿色能源的运营，但是它的工业是不稳定的，是随着复合的变化而变。那么越南的经济现在在飞速发展，它是要有选择。那么在中国呢，我们集团也是在努力的发展绿色能源。那么这一块呢，一个是我们集团有循环经济，这一块呢是能减碳，循环经济整个循环过程减少运输量，减少能耗的损失，降低排放，这个整个是减碳。那么绿色能源怎样接触到工业和大的能源行业，这个也是现在我们中国企业也在积极的探索。那好多新的技术在实施，我认为克服这个能源的消耗的稳定性这一块，包括咱们现在的储能，这是一个方向。那现在这个还有一段的时间。那么作为企业端，怎样让复苏能也能波动试试绿色能源这一块呢，这个无论哪个国家哪个企业都是面临的课题。那么只有创新，只有创新才能让这些难题在逐步的克服。因为企业在不断的生产过程中会遇到很多这样大的问题，那么现在的绿色能源就是一个正在面临的课题我相信随着我们科技的发展， 随着我们企业不断的研发，绿色能源可以持续的供给下游的企业生产。那么火，随着火力发电正在逐步的减少，那么我认为呢，零碳排放的这一天，我认为在不久的将来很快就能到达。谢谢。
好，谢谢张总。Thank you very much, Mr. Zhang. About the English, also talk about the English. Emission, right?
Time flies. We have
fun. Yes,
but one statement.
Yeah,
I just wanted to, was very happy to learn that the entire fleet of delivery trucks of Pepsi Cola use Jack electric truck.
Right.
So Jack is helping save the environment in Brazil as well.
Yeah, Miss Wong is very proud, right? And Jack is a deliver with electricity truck in Brazil, right? So that's wonderful. Yeah. Time flies, so we are almost time to wrap up this exciting session, right? This morning, the Deputy Prime Minister reminded us that we want to have ideas and also actions for impact. Right? So this time, I actually just ask each of our five distinguished panelists just one sentence. What's the most exciting takeaways from these 2 days of program of Horizons that we talk about collaboration, the future collaboration between China and the United States? Ms. Linda, start with you first.
I think anything for I-92 days is the incredible opportunity that is here in Vietnam for growth and development. And I encourage international organizations, they must come work with Vietnam companies and work with Chinese companies to really pave the way forward looking to the future.
Thank you. David, your conclusion remark.
Yeah, every year I have taught economic class, and always I talk to my students, one of the economic principles, that is a trade make everyone better off. Trade make every nation better off. Last year, between Vietnam and China, the trade is over $300 billion. It's number one partner in the ASEAN, in the Southeast Asia. So, you know, last night, I bought in Chinese, it's called a durian, in English, it's called a durian, the big one. The big one here is only RMB, is 160 RMB, but in China, 1,060 RMB. Please, export durian to China.
Thank you. One good business, right? Charles, maybe just one sentence, please. One sentence. What's the major takeaways from this two exciting days?
I think the collaboration between Vietnam and China will be very, very important for Vietnam also to become a high-tech country like China is today.
Thank you, Charles. Huang Dong, yeah, 这两天很exciting的这个项目，你觉得就是说 take away 是什么主要的？对的。
我认为我们在越南Better drive and better life. 我们用最好的产品去满足越南人的生活。
谢谢 ，Thank you。张总，你的心得。
越南和我们唇齿相依，文化相近，我感觉呢，我们中国和越南的企业发展前景非常广阔，我很有期待。谢谢。
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, so that concludes this exciting program of this closing plenary. Let's give all speakers a big hand. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. So that's good to go together. Thank you. So ladies and gentlemen, let's wrap up our today's conference. And also, it's close our Horizons China 2024. Thank you all of you for your participation and hope that you get a lot of insights and enjoy the moment in our Bundesverbands. Thank you so much. Wish you all the best for the future and hope to see you soon. Yeah. So for those who are invited, buses are